תשמחי נפשי אס השם. Today in page 42 we're going to study first הלכות חימום בשבת, heating or melting water on Shabbat. We're going to elaborate of different options and how and what we can or cannot do. Also, we're going to study at depth the Kli Rishon, Kli Sheni, the first, the second, the third vessels, how we can use it and which term. What we learned yesterday is the whole concept of Davar She'eino Mitkoven. For those who just walk in, let's understand what we are discussing here. Shmuel hold that a person allowed to do some type of work if they some type of intent permitted work if the consequence happened that wasn't permitted, which means as long as you are not intent to do it, therefore whatever is a consequence, it's not part of your obligation of responsibility of the prohibition. So the Gemara here is based on the assumption that unintentional action and the labor that is not necessarily for his own sake are interdependent, which means there are some relationship between the two, which means if an action is necessary for its own sake, so a person not intend to perform certain aspect and it happened, so you don't hold him a responsibility for the result. But if one performs an unintentional action clearly and the result happens something else, then again we have to research the exact intent. Shmuel hold that if the intent was something that allow and the consequences, another second consequence that was not allowed, a person should not hold responsibility for that. So with that, we try to compare or juxtapose Shmuel's opinion to Rabbi Shimon. Lemeimra de Shmuel ki Rabbi Shimon svir alei. You meant to say that Shmuel hold the same as Rabbi Shimon, that hold that somebody who did something unintentional and his intent was something that is permissible, we say that it's fine, we're not obligated. Ve'amar Shmuel מחבין גחלת של מתכת ברשות הרבים בשביל שלא יזוכו ברבים, אבל לא גחלת של עץ. Shmuel said that one permit adding water even in an amount of sufficient to harden the vessel holds in according of Rabbi Shimon, which means one may extinguish a piece of white hot metal in a public area on Shabbat, so that the masses will not be injured. Imagine if you have in a public domain something that can injure people, because this is a piece of white hot metal, is not actual fire, and the extinguisher is prohibited by the rabbinic decree, not the Torah law. So the sages did not issue a decree in situation where there is a concern for public safety. However, one may not extinguish a red-hot wood coal because extinguishing it is prohibited by Torah law. So that's basically what Rashi and Tosfot here. The Melechet Kibui extinguishing applied to wood that turned to be coal. That's the Chazon Ish Or HaChaim. Chapter 50 elaborate on that, but he said that it's the whole metal is a rabbinic, but the rabbis did not put a decree in the place that is in danger for public, for masses. There is another concept the Ramban said, it's called tziruf, which means that tziruf, that combining, that applied to a kli for utensil. So many of the Geonics say that when it's applied to public, you have to differentiate between something that you see the reddened that coming out of those pieces of metal versus wood. In wood, it's clear and people can see it. So people can see it, so you assure that people will not endanger themselves because they see that out of the wood, the redden coming out. Versus if it's metal, people not see it. And it, because it's not unseen, it can create a public a damage for many. So therefore, there's a very big dispute. The Ramban, the Rashba, the Ran, many have a big dispute in if this is a biblical or rabbinic to deal with metal item that it's damaged to public. Anyway, ואיס על כדעתך סבר לה כרבי שמעון אפילו של עץ נמי. If you say that he hold like Rabbi Shimon, so even you allow even to extinguish a wood product. Why? Because this considering melachash, that labor that not necessary for its own sake. Melachash שאינה צריכה לגופה. So maybe you say that Shmuel hold the same as Rabbi Shimon and he allow it. The Gemara responds and they said, בדבר שאין מתכוון סבר לה כרבי שמעון. Shmuel hold the same as Rabbi Shimon in a labor that not necessary for its own sake, and therefore he allowed to fill up that pot with the water, with the cold water, because he did not intend to do tziruf, to combine it. However, במלאכה שאינה צריכה לגופה סבר לה כרבי יהודה. But when it's come to a melacha for some type of work that that it's not necessary for its own sake, he hold that it's liable according to opinion of Rabbi Yehuda. So therefore he forbade to extinguish a fire that came out of a wood in a public domain, even there is a concern that maybe many will be damaged, because the prohibition he hold that it's biblical. Which means these two entities, which is דבר שאינו מתכוון, an unintentional act, and מלאכה שאינה צריכה לגופה, labor that it's not necessary for its own sake, it's not interdependent, it's not connected to each other. That most of the rabbis hold, like Ritva and Ran and many, that the only thing that the Torah forbade is melechet machshevet. It's something that you have full mind and full intent, but something that happened unintentionally, then you cannot compare it. It's not, it's rabbinic. That's the way that the many mefarshim, Pnei Yoshua, Ratva, Rashba, and more. Amar Ravina. So now Ravina derived another conclusion. That basically we say that we allow when it's a public damage, when it's a public domain, and it may create damage for public, hilkach kotz birshut rabim molicho pachot pachot me'arba amot bekarmelit ve'afilu tuva. Therefore, a throne in a public domain, on Shabbat, one may move a throne or other obstacles in a public domain to the sides of the public domain. Right, because he moved it 400, 4 cubits, so people were not injured by this. And it's in a Carmelite, one may move the obstacle even more than 4 cubits at a time. That's the Ravina opinion. Because again, this is a serious concern. It's damaged the public. Now, we learn the Mishnah. Aval noten. The Mishnah said that one may place water into the vessel in order to warm it. Okay? Tanu Rabbanan. Now, we speak about all these option when a person can do that. To combine cold and hot water during Shabbat. Tanu Rabbanan. The rabbis teach us in the Braita. נותן אדם חמין לתוך הצונן ולא הצונן לתוך החמין דברי בית שמאי. The person may place a hot water into a cold water but not cold in too hot. This is the statement of Beit Shammai. So what's the reason of Beit Shammai? Beit Shammai allowed to pour a hot water even from the first, from Kli Rishon, from the first vessel into a cold water, but forbids to put cold water to a hot water even for Kli Sheni, even the second one. Tosfot here elaborate one, because there is a concept that's called Tata'a Gavar, that when you put something hot to something cold, or something cold to something hot, the Tata'a, the bottom one, has more power than the top. Which means, if the cold one is on the bottom, and you put the hot melted the cold, right? But it cannot cook the cold one. But if a hot is in the bottom, and you put cold into the hot part will warm the cold one before the cold one make the hot cold, right? So therefore, you can pour a hot water into the cold one, because the hot water will be colden, but you cannot put cold water to a hot one, because the cold water will be cooked. That's what Rashi said. So, as according to the Torah, what is a Kli Sheni, when is the second one? So you can pour something cold to something hot, because the second one, it's not some type of cooking, even that is in the bottom one. Beit Shammai forbade it. Usually Beit Shammai is the more stringent, because they afraid, that's what Tosfot said here, that people mix between Kli Rishon and Kli Sheni, which for most probably most of the people who are not familiar will mix up between the two. So that's the concern the rabbis had. Now, Beit Hillel omrim, Beit Hillel disagree, and they said, Ben Chamin letoch Hatzunen, Ben Tzunen letoch Chamin mutar. Beit Hillel said that both hot into cold and cold into hot is permitted. So, Ran explained that according to Beit Hillel, all this decree from the Kli Rishon, it's not applicable. B'me dvarim amurim. In what case we holding here? Because, which means, if you take water, the water is need for what? The purpose of that cup? For drinking. So if you use the water for drinking, a person doesn't want that the water should be overwhelmingly hot, right? Most of the people doesn't want too hot. So he add some cold water in order for that water will not be so warm. So that cup is considering Kli Sheni, and Kli Sheni, we said, what we said in Kli Sheni, that it's not considering Mevashel, it's not considering cooking. Mm-hmm. So therefore, you allow. Aval be'am batei, if he is ducking himself with a pool, right, like mikveh or tub, right? So if he put inside the tub, chamin letoch tzonen, velo tzonen letoch chamin. Which means you can add, if you have the foundation of the water in the pool that it's cold, and you add hot water to the cold on the bottom, that's okay. However, if it's in the opposite, which means you have a hot water in the pool and it's smoke coming out of the hot water and you're adding cold water, what basically you're doing? You are changing the status of those water. So therefore, the ambati, this type of the pool, it's considering a Kli Rishon. Why? Because the water was directly heated in that pool. So adding a cold water, it's a problem. And we said Rabbi Shimon ben Nasya oser. Rabbi Shimon ben Nasya go to the extreme in that sense, and he hold that even putting hot into cold is prohibited. And Amar Rav Nachman alacha k'Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya. So let's make sure that we are all on the same page. Here we talk about a Kli Rishon, but we have this pool. What's the issue with pull? So it's a Gemara in Psachim that have a controversy between Rav and Shmuel in regard to Ila'a Gavar or Tata'a Gavar, which means when you talk about pull, for example, the mikveh, are you considering the bottom, the key point, or the top, the key point? If you go by the Rav said that the one at the top are the key, the Shmuel Sofer, the one at the bottom. What's the real difference? Which means that if the top is hot and the bottom is cold, so he hold that the top can warm up the bottom. If you go by the opposite way, the bottom warm the top. Okay? So here what we said, halakha, ki Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya, meaning that soon we explain what exactly the situation Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya hold. Savar Rav Yosef lemeimar, Rav Yosef thought to say that the sefel hareu ke'am betei, which means if you take a sefel, like a large cup, like the one we use for washing our hands.
Okay.
So he said that sefel or cup, it's klisheni, is the second one. Usually, the second reason is that the water there, it's usually for drinking purposes. So he said, therefore, according to Beit Hillel, it's forbidden to pour a cold water into a hot water. Again, you have this large pot, for example, that contain a hot water, and you're taking a cold water and you pour it in, so Beit Hillel hold that you cannot do it. Either because that water is for drinking, or you say that the course is klisheni. Amar le'abaye, tani rabichia sefel eno ke'am batei. He hold that this cup of water, it has no, it's not the same as a bath. That because this basin, it's not like a bath term of pouring water into it. So you can put the cold water inside. Ulemai de salik adata miikara. If according to Rav Yosef, that he hold the sefel areu ke'am batei, that he will say that it's a basin is like a bath with regard to this halacha. Ve'amar Rav Nachman halacha ki Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya, which means that he forbade even to pour a hot water into a cold water. So the Rashba said, it means that Rav Yosef hold the same as Rav Nachman. Ela b'shabbat rechitza b'chamin leika. It means that you allow in which way you can use a hot water on Shabbat, washing with one water, because you can find a way that you use a hot water in Shabbat. Early we said in 39, if the water was prepared in advance, you can wash face, hand, and feet on Shabbat. And now you're asking a question: how you can use that water? So he said, "Misavart Rabbi Shimon aseifakai." You hold that what Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya hold is for the second part of the Braita, which means that Beit Hillel allowed to pour a hot water into cold water, and Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya forbids, which means that again it's irui, that it's pouring from Kli Rishon, and you basically indirectly cooking the cold water. So Beit Hillel matirin. But Beit Hillel allow ben chamin letoch tzonen, uben tzonen letoch chamin, regardless if it's a hot to a cold or cold to a hot. Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya oser tzonen letoch chamin. Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya hold that tata agavar, which means the bottom one, is the one that we go by. So again, so if you have a mikveh or a pool that they have the bottom of a very hot water, okay, that's a problem. But if you have a hot water that you put inside a pool that have a cold water, he said that even usually Rabbi Shimon ben Asya, here in that sense, he hold that even taking cold water to the water is a problem, but he agreed that if the bottom one it's cold and the top, the one that you add, it's hot, even Rabbi Shimon ben Menasseh said that that it's okay. So it means that because we hold the tata gavar, which means the bottom is the one who makes the difference, so therefore a cold water, even to klisheni, for the second vessels, Rabbi Shimon ben Menasseh forbids. So now the Gemara asks, because Leima Rabbi Shimon ben Menasseh de Amar kebeit Shammai. So you mean to say that Rabbi Shimon ben Menasseh hold the same as Beit Shammai, that basically they forbid to pour a cold water inside the hot water of the cup, and that's against Beit Hillel, and that's impossible, because we said in Brachot 36, so that Beit Shammai b'mkom Beit Hillel eina Mishnah. So basically we cannot go by in this way. So we said that if Hachi Ke'amar, you have to say that Rabbi Shimon ben Menasseh meant to say as follows: Lo nechelku Beit Shammai bedavar ze. He hold that Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel did not dispute in this matter, which means Rabbi Shimon ben Menasseh had a different tradition with regard to the opinions of Beit Hillel and Beit Shammai. And here we bring in a story. Amar Rav Huna b'rei de Rav Yoshua, Chazina leid l'Rava de lo kapid amana. I saw that Rava was not so strict in the case of vessel, made no distinction between cold and hot, which means he will have no problem to put cold water into a hot water if it was klisheni, and it makes no difference if it's a sefel, if it's a cup. Midetanei Rabbi Chia, that's the way Rabbi Chia taught this leniency. Noten adam kiton shel mayim l'toch sefel mayim ben chamin l'toch tzonen ben tzonen l'toch chamin. He holds that a person can place a jar of water into a basin of water, both hot into cold and cold into hot. And Yotzei, it means that this braita hold that you are allowed to put the cold water even to a cup that it's hot. Okay? So, Amar Lei Rav Huna Le Rav Ashi, Dilma shane atam de mafsik li. Rav Huna said to Rav Ashi, there is a weakness in this proof, because there is a difference between the vessel form of partition between the hot and the cold water. He's not pouring a cold water into a basin itself, but he's placing a jar whose sides from the partition into the basin. So Amar Lei, so how do we know that we can put the cold water into a hot basin? He said, Amar Lei Rav Ashi said to Rav Huna, Me'arei itmar. He said, here we talk about pouring itmar, we learned, but not ten that the person put. So the correct version should be, Me'arei adam kiton shel mayim l'toch sefel shel mayim. A person may pour a jug of water into a basin of water, bein chamin letoch tzonen, bein tzonen letoch chamin, both hot into cold and cold into hot, and therefore there is no room of distinction between the two cases. So let's wrap it up, a 5 point that we learned. Everyone agreed that you cannot put a cold water into a pool, for example mikveh, that it's hot. Imagine if you have a pool of water like mikveh, that they have a very hot water there, so the hot water in the pool, it's considering kli rishon, because we have the tata'a gavah. Tata'a is the bottom that makes the difference. So this part, it's much stronger than the cold water. And therefore, what happened to the cold water, we hold, it's like bishul. It's like you cook the cold water that you put in. Point one. Point two. Putting in that pool hot water into cold water, it depends upon the two way we take it. According to Tosfot, Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel both allowed, and Rabbi Shimon ben Benassia forbade it. And we follow Rabbi Shimon ben Benassia that is forbidden. Rif, however, hold that it's allowed, which means Rif hold that both Beit Shammai, Beit Hillel, and Rabbi Shimon ben Benassia hold that you can put a hot water into a pool of cold water. Third point we learn, that we can put a hot water in the cup into a cold water because the tata gavar, the bottom one, is the strongest one. Four, if you have a kli sheni, which is the second one, and you want to take a cup with hot water and melt it a little bit, and you put a cold water in it, so according to Tosfot, Beit Shammai forbade, and Beit Hillel and Rabbi Shimon ben Benassia allowed. And according to Halacha, which we have later at the end of this shiur, we're allowed to do it according to Rava. According to the Rif, the Tanakama hold, the first one hold, that Beit Shammai forbids and Beit Hillel allowed, and Rabbi Shimon ben Benassia hold that even Beit Hillel forbids. So it means Rav Nachman hold the same as Rabbi Shimon ben Benassia to forbid it, and Rava hold the same as Tanakama, the first one, and Beit Hillel to allow. And basically halakha according to Rava, which means that we are lenient. Fifth point, if you have a cup, like sefer, that you use it for washing, so we hold it the same as a regular cup and not the same halakha as pool. That's basically what we wrap up is according to Rashi, Tosfot, Chidushi Aran, Rashba, I have a different thing, but when we get to the point of halakha, we bring this the tour in Shulchan Aruch. Let's go to the Mishnah, the very bottom of the page. Now, just word of introduction before we go to the Mishnah. We are here dealing with taking a spices or other tavlinim inside either Kli Rishon or Kli Sheni on Shabbat. Because what we speak so far in sense of preparation for Shabbat, we have to know that there is an issue of labor involved with cooking on Shabbat. So we have a certain prohibition which is a, like something that's set aside, we call it Muktzeh, involved with Shabbat. So here is an example. Cooking. So when you have the prohibition of cooking, what's the issue here? Ilfas. Ilfas is like machvat, is like the pot. The
frying pan.
What?
Frying pan.
Thank you. Frying pan. Mm-hmm. So that frying pan, והגדרה, and the pot, שהעבירן מרותחים, that it stand in Erev Shabbat, before Shabbat, on the fire. And this is during the twilight time. That's usually according to the Gemara in Psachim, Mem, that's usually the time that most of the people take out hot pot and remove it to a different location. So at that time when it's still hot, lo yiten letochan tavlin, which means even they are removed before Shabbat, a person may not place spicy into them on Shabbat itself, even though the pot is not actually standing on a fire. the spices are still cooked in it because the pot is a primary vessel and the vessel whose content will cook on the fire. And the Rashi said that if Ayad Soledet Bo, if it's so hot, even Kli Rishon is the issue because Namer Asher, but Ritva hold that is regardless if it's Yad Soledet or not Yad Soledet, as long as it's hot, the minutes that you remove it from the fire when it's still hot, it's a problem because people usually add these spices before the serving it. Now, if you go by our previous discussion, we discussed the issue of Ila Gavar and Tata Gavar, if the top is makes a difference or the bottom. Think now when it's come to spices. If you tell me Ila Agavar, which means the top makes the difference, apply also in Kli Sheni in something hot, because basically you are cooking something that it's on the top and it's penetrate to the bottom. We turn the page, 42b, Aval notenhu, a person can put a spices לתוך הקערה או לתוך התמחוי, into a bowl or into a תמחוי, it's like the turing, mm-hmm. which is a large bowl that people put and store pot on a pot. Both of them are secondary vessel. There's like Kli Sheni. And if you put something there, it's not basically cooking it. That's what Rashi said. Rashi hold that these small vessels that you basically transferred is already Kli Shlishi, is the third one. And what we said here in the Mishnah, it's a Kli Sheni. So he said, Kli Sheni is not cooking. And the beauty of that is that the Tiferet Yisrael on this Mishnah said that even it's hot in the level of Yad Soledet, that it's so hot, still, since it's a Kli Sheni, since it's a secondary, so we don't have an issue. But we said it's all apply if it's a liquid or if it's some type of a spicy, like liquid spices. But if it's one item that it's like strong, dry item, then it's a different story. Because that's, it's not melted the same as a liquid, and it's basically can cook even in Kli Sheni. That's what Magen Avraham said. Rabbi Yehuda omer lakol unoten. You can put a spice in everything. Chutz midavar sheyesh bo chometz vetzir. He said, excluding a vessel that has in it something containing vinegar or brine of salted fish. Meaning, the big issue here, Rashi said, it's the issue if you consider that Kli Rishon or Kli Sheni. That's what the Gemara said. But it's a book called Eg Letal that he elaborate a lot on this Mishnah, just above the scope and the time of this session.
That makes sense. I mean, acidic substances like brine and vinegar, you know, break down the food faster, so it really does change the state of the food.
That's so, the concern.
Yeah,
that's
that makes, that makes sense. Yeah.
In the book Eg Letal, he expanded tremendously mm-hmm. of what's involved here and what's the difference between gush yavesh, liquid, rotev.
Right.
In general term, liquid, it's much different than something dry and big part.
Mm-hmm.
The process is very different. Ibailu, Gemara. The dilemma was raised before the sages. Rabbi Yehuda Reisha Kai Ulekula or Aseifa Kai Ulechumra. One Rabbi Yehuda mentioned at the beginning of the Mishnah in a prohibition to take spices into a pot or into a ilfas, a stew pot. He meant to say that it's lenient if it's not straight on the fire. You can add that chometz, that vinegar or brine, or it go by the second part, which means to put something inside a pot and it's ulechumra, that it's more stringent. So, because the rabbi said that one is permitted to place spices into a bowl or in the turing, and the Rabbi Yehuda came to add another chumra, another stringency, and said that the bowl contained vinegar or brine is prohibited to place spices into them. So, Tashma, we learn from another brayta, the Tanya, Rabbi Yehuda Omer lechol ha'il pasim. He said that all the ilpasin, all the ilpasin, he used the word as a stew pot. And unoten, all this unoten, he can put a spices. Ulechol hakderot rotchot unoten, and even the hot pot, you can put these spices, excluding chutz midavar sheyesh bo chometz vetzir, excluding except for one who contain vinegar or brine. So this is very clearly indication from this braita that Rabbi Yehuda disputes the first clause of the Mishnah, and it's basically more lenient. Savar Rav Yosef lemeimar, Rav Yosef come and say, melach hare hu ketavlin, salt have the same rules as spices, the bechli rishon bashla, that it's cooked at the kli rishon, at the first vessel, ubechli sheni lo bashla. So therefore, you cannot put it on the first one, the klirishon, but you can put it on the klisheni, the second one. Amar le'abayei tani Rabbi Chiya, melach eina ketavlin. Rabbi Chiya said that salt is not like spices, meaning that it's much stringent in that sense. Why? The bechlisheni na mebashla, that melach can be cooked even in the klisheni, so therefore you cannot put it in the klisheni as long as it's hot in a level that yad soledet bo. So it's a side note, the Gemara said, Upliga, the Rav Nachman, Rav Nachman disagree with this. The Amar Rav Nachman tzricha milta bishula kebisra de Torah. He hold that salt have a level of cooking the same as ox meat, which means that ox meat is such a level of meat that even you put it in a clear rishon, you take it out of a fire, if it's not straight on the fire, it's not going to be cooked properly, and you need to put this level of meat straight on the fire. So he said that you can put the salt even in the clear rishon with one condition, as long, Rashi said, as long as it's not direct on the fire. So he said, the ikah de amrei, it's another option to understand this discussion. Savar Rav Yosef lemeimar melach hareu ketavlin, the bechli rishon bashla, he hold that salt is the same as spices because it was cooked in the kli rishon. Bechli sheni lo bashla, but the second vessel it wasn't cooked. Amar le abayei, tani Rabbi Chiya, abayei said that that's what Rabbi Chiya meant. Melach ena ketavlin, melach is more lenient than the spices. Why? The bechli rishon name lo bashla, that even in the first vessel it wasn't cooked. At Tosfot here, the Mu'a Matchil Vainu said that it's a machloket rishonim at the first place if you go by the first version or the second version. But the Shulchan Aruch said that salt is not going to cook even on the clear rishon if it's not straight on the fire. That's the way Rav Nachman said. Anyway, Vainu Damar Rav Nachman Tzricha Milcha Bishula Kebisra de Torah. That's exactly what Rav Nachman said, that salt needs to be cooked the same as a ox meat. Now, it's important to note that the Mordechai said that we are here may mix two different categories of salt. There is a salt that we have in our discussion here that you collect it from the ground without being processed.
Okay.
But our day's salt, that it's a combination of water, salt water that was cooked, so that's not applied. That's chumrah, it's not applied to that. Because there is a concept that is called ein bishul achar bishul, cannot cook after cook. It's not...
So it's already cooked, so you can't cook it again.
Can't cook it again. Okay, now, Mishnah. As I said, at the end of the shiur, we go to the practical halachot. Now, from this point up to the end of this chapter, the whole Mishnah you're dealing with the Muktzeh. Muktzeh is crucial. It's a lot of halachot. Muktzeh is basically item that's set aside, and we're going to have a lot of halachot in regard to Muktzeh when it's come to lighting Shabbat candles. I would like to give some type of introduction to the Muktzeh for people who are not so familiar with Muktzeh. When it's come to Muktzeh, something that's set aside, the rabbis put a decree that you allowed to eat on Shabbat a cooked product only if it was prepared in advance before Shabbat. Because when it was a time that we received manna from heaven, that the time that Jewish people were wandering in a desert, the Torah said in Shmot, in Exodus chapter 16, V'haya bayom ha-shishi, and it was on the sixth day, V'hechinu et asher yaviu, and they prepared the food in advance. Which means, if the food, cooked food, was not prepared, quote-unquote, in advance, it's considering a set aside, it's like Muktzeh, and you cannot eat it. So, therefore, if it's a Muktzeh, so you cannot move it from one location to another. And there is a concept we discussed earlier, which called Migo, the Itkatzai Bein Hashmashot. Since it's set aside in a twilight before Shabbat, Itkatzai Lekule Yoma, which means that it's become a Muktzeh for the entire time, entire day. Amar, Enotnim, Mishnah, Enotnim, Kli Tachat Haner, Lekabel Bo Et HaShemen. On Shabbat, you cannot put a vessel under the candle in order to collect the oil that come out of candles. Again, this is the ancient time. It was constant dropping from the candles, and that oil that coming out of the candle, it's considering Muktzeh. It's like set aside, and therefore asur betil tul. You cannot carry it. So the Mishnah wants to teach us that we cannot on Shabbat. If you look and you see this candle, imagine that if you have olive oil candle, and you see that outside is start dripping, coming out, you cannot take another vessel to collect
and then use it, right?
Right, and use it. Either it's a machloket. Later we see, either it's because ein kli nital el tzorech davar nital, which means you cannot move or carry a vessel on Shabbat only for something that you're allowed to carry, but Muktzeh, set aside, that is forbidden to carry, you cannot carry. Or, in other ways, it's because you cannot levatel kli meichano, which means a vessel that was set up to use on Shabbat, you can carry, but you cannot put it in a place that you change the status that you designated in advance. So because that vessel is forbidden to carry it from one place to another, it's like you set up a spot in that place and it's like become a permanent. It's like a bnia, it's like building, it's like set up. So because the minute you put that vessel under that, it's became a basis, a foundation for that dripping oil that it's Muktzeh, that's set aside, and it's called basis, a foundation ledavar asur, that you cannot carry, you cannot move it from one location to another. So all of that apply to the oil inside the candle, as long as the candles are lit. Okay? Why? Number one, it's basically mechabe, because indirectly you're extinguishing it. Number two, it's because the oil is the basis for that fire. And three, the oil, it's basically set aside for a certain mitzvah, which is lighting candles on Shabbat. And therefore, you cannot use it. However,
so
the big question
a
after...
A Muktzeh item you can move even within a Rishut HaYechid?
Right, okay. Any location, you cannot move it. Okay. Now, How about the oil that stayed in that candle after it was extinguished? So that is a Tanaic disputes. Later we're going to read it in 44. Some say that motar ha-shemen ha-shemen ba-kara asur, that is forbidden. Rabbi Shimon allow it. And we're going to discuss it when we get there. So the Mishnah said, En notnim. One may not place a vessel beneath the oil lamp, the vessel containing oil and the wick, on Shabbat, in order to receive the oil that drips from the wick. Ve'im netanu mibe'od yom mutar. But if one places the vessels on Friday while it's still day, it's permitted. And you don't need to remove it from one location to the other. So some, like Pnei Yoshua, understand this Rashi here, that that's apply only b'diavad. If it's already, you put it, you don't need, you cannot move it. Because the fear is that you basically carry that vessel on Shabbat after the oil dripped there. Now, ואין נאותים ממנו לפי שאינו מן המוכן. But if the oil dripped from the candle to that vessel that you prepare in advance, you cannot derive any joy from that oil because it was not from the oil that prepared from Shabbat Eve, from Friday, for use on Shabbat. So the oil in the lamp was already set aside and designated solely for the purpose of lighting the lamp. So that's part of the mukzeh, that it's set aside. The Chatam Sofer explained that regardless if the oil is inside the candle or the oil that drop outside of the of that, both of them because it's basically forbidden, you cannot use it regardless. The Gemara said, Amar Rav Chisda said, אף על פי שאמרו נותנים כלי תחת תרנגולת לקבל ביצתה, אבל כופה עליה כדי שלא תישבר. Which means you have a hen that's dropping an egg. So you cannot place a vessel beneath the hen preparing to lay on an egg on Shabbat, right? But you can place that egg to prevent from breaking it when it falls. So in other words, you can overturning the vessel into an egg on Shabbat that it will not be trampled and break. That's okay. At the beginning of Tractate Beitzah, we said that egg that was born on Shabbat, it's considering a mukzeh. It's set aside. You cannot use it. So if you have the hen, you cannot place in that vessel under the hen, because the same as you said about dripping from a candle, that is a problem, the same thing here. So what's the really difference between a hen, an egg, and dripping oil from the candle? Amar Rabba Maitama de Rav Chisda. Rabba said, what's the reason of Rav Chisda said it? Kasavar tarnegolet asuya latil beitzata ba'ashpa. So hen can go ahead and drop the egg in the trash and people will step on. Ve'na asuya latil beitzata b'mkom midron. The hen will not put the egg in a place that it's like midron, it's like
an incline.
Incline, thank you. Ve'atzala metzuya, which means that a place that people will step in, hitiru. The sages allowed to carry a vessel for that. Even he does that for mukze, like egg. Ve'atzala she'ena metzuya, which is like, for example, they using the egg in inclining place, lo itiru, the sage is not allowed to carry a vessel for that it's mukzeh. Because en kli nital, ela ledavar anital. which means the carry will you are forbidden to carry a vessel only for certain basis that it's allowed. Etivei Abaye, so Abaye ask, since you tell me that you're not allowed to carry a vessel for mukze only in the state of saving something, like saving, or said vehatzala she'ena metzuya. So what do you do in the something that it's uncommon case of preservation, so like placing a vessel beneath a hen to receive an egg that will not roll down an inclined surface, right? So he said lo yitiru, that the sages did not allow. He said vehatanya, but we learn in the Braita that nishbera lo chavit shel tevel berosh gago, one whose barrel of untied produce, it's tevel, you know, it's the produce that's supposed to take a tight, but it doesn't tight yet, which may not be eaten until it's tight, and broke on the top of his roof on Shabbat, mevikli, he bring a vessel, umeniach tachtea, in a place beneath the barrel, so that the untied produce is not lost. Even though eating untied produce is prohibited on Shabbat, they permitted carrying a vessel to preserve it, even if an uncommon case of barrel that breaks. So he said, "Begulfei." So you see that they allowed to carry that vessel for the purpose of saving the tevel, the untied. So Rava said, "Begulfei chadetei." The shchichei de pakei. Here you're talking about new barrels, which commonly break. So it's considering hatzala metzuya, and we're allowed to carry a vessel for that purpose. Second question, Abaye ask. Etivei, Abaye ask from Mishnah. We're going to study in Memzayin in 47b. Notnim kli tachat aner lekabel bo nitzotzot. We allow to place a vessel beneath the oil lamp in order to receive a burning sparks of oil that drip from the burning wick, even though this is not common. You know, sometimes in the old days, it's like those sparks that coming out, it's even dangerous. Okay? What's the fear? That if you have close by, like shade, like other things, it can be burned. And it's a mukze mechamat gufo. And it's very rare, it's not common. And even though the Mishnah allowed to carry a vessel in order to receive them. So Rabbah answered and he said, Nitzotzot nami shchicha. He said, no, don't think that way. Sparks are also common. Again, you have to remember that this is Talmudic time. And therefore it's common a case of preservations. So basically, according to the Tosfot here, in the place that you have sparks, that it's more common than you have a egg from the hen in a reclining place. It's not so common that people will put in advance on Friday a vessel for that sparks, Tosfot said. But still, it's a concern. מחבין גחלת של מתכת. This is a Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim 334. One is permitted to extinguish on Shabbat a lamp of white hot metal located in a place where it could cause injury, as the ruling of Shmuel. As a wood coal, the Rambam prohibited extinguish it, while other authorities permit doing it because most of the halachic authorities rule that that where Rabbi Shimon said that, and that's what the Mishnah Berurah said in Eliyahu Rabbah. How about kotz birshut harabim? If you have a throne in a public domain, so it's a something that create an obstacle for public. So one allowed to move a throne or other obstacle on the birshut harabim in a public domain on this to put it aside in the Arba Amot, in the 4 cubit. Now, if it's a Carmelite, Then the Rambam said in Chod Shabbat, chapter 1, and also Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim 308 said, that one may remove the obstacle even more than Arba Amot, for the four cubits at a time. That's the Ravina said. Now, if you remember, we talk about Ila Gavar Tata Gavar, the bottom hat, the top hat, pouring. So, let's go for the first one. Hot water into cold. Chamin letoch tzonen. Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim 318 said, pouring a large quantity of cold water into a vessel that was emptied of hot water in order to warm the cold water is permitted. In addition, there is no reason for concern that one will thereby harden the metal of the vessel, since he did not intend to perform that action. That's the statement of Beit Hillel, and the way that Abaye said in Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya statement. How about cold into hot? Tzonen letoch hachamim. Adding cold water to hot water in a primary vessel on Shabbat is prohibited. He said, if there is so much cold water that it will not become exceedingly hot, the Ramah said that it's permitted as long as the vessel is not on the fire. If the hot water is a klisheini, is a secondary vessel, it is permitted. There are authorities who prohibited this in the large tub, even if it is a klisheini, if it is a secondary vessel, there are still rabbis that prohibited. Spices. We discuss putting tavlinim, spices. That's Shulchan Aruch 318, and also the Mishnah Berurah said, "Lo yiten letocha tavlin." It is prohibited to place spices into a primary vessel, even after it was removed from the fire, as long as one's hand spontaneously recoils from it due to its heat. That's the Mishnah. Other authorities are more stringent, stating that it's prohibited to do so even when the primary vessel is not so hot that one's hand spontaneously recalls that. That's the Magen Avraham based on the Yerushalmi Talmud and also the Baal HaTanya, Shulchan Aruch HaRav. Adding spices to a secondary vessel is permitted even if it is not so, if it's so hot that one's hands Yad Soledet Bo, spontaneously recalls from it. Salt. We hold that salt, in a final word, it's different. It's not like a spice. Melach Eina Tavlin. Sprinkling salt into a primary vessel after it was taken off the fire is permitted. That's the second version of the Gemara, because the Halacha tends to establish according to the second version. However, if in the way that Rav Nachman and Abayis arrangement, the Ramah said that putting salt even into a secondary vessel, klisheini, the Ramah said that is prohibited, but the Taz said he accepted the first statement in the Gemara, which means it's proper to be stringent in this matter. That's what the Ramah hold. But again, you see that it's a big machloket apolskim in that. How about kli tachat haner, vessel beneath the oil lamp? So Shulchan Aruch Or HaChaim 265 said, one may not place a vessel beneath an oil lamp on Shabbat to receive the oil. Placing a vessel beneath the oil lamp before Shabbat begins, like in Erev Shabbat, it's okay, it's permitted. However, the oil may not be used on Shabbat, that's the Mishnah said. How about overturning a vessel onto an egg? If you have those farm place or place that you have a hen, overturning a vessel onto an egg that was laid on Shabbat is permitted. The halacha apply to protecting other set aside object from damage, mukze, both on Shabbat and on festival. That's the opinion of Rav Chisda. But in general, we say that bishul medlach, cooking salt, has a different category because it's very difficult to articulate and precise the definition of cooking salt. So all this comparison between overturning a vessel into egg and vessel beneath the oil lamp and the salt is not spicy, we hold it as a three different point. One has nothing to do with the others, and we do not connect it between the all three.
Hashem.